This meeting is being conducted utilizing teleconferencing and electronic means with the State of California Executive Order N-29-20, dated March 17th, 2020, regarding the COVID-19 pandemic. Planning commissioners and staff who have joined the meeting, please mute your microphones and unmute when called upon and acknowledged by the chairperson. In accordance with the Executive Order N-29-20, and based on the guidance from the California Department of Public Health, in order to minimize the spread of COVID-19 virus, city meetings may be observed live at https://salinas.legistar, which is legistar.com/calendar.astx on Salinas channel on YouTube at https://www.youtube.com/user/the Salinas channel. Advanced submittal of public comments by email were due today by 1:30 p.m. to the Planning Commission Secretary at public comment cd-p@ci.salinas.ca.us. If you're watching the live stream and wish to make either a general public comment or to comment on a specific item as is being heard, please join the Zoom webinar at https://zoom.us/j910208716/06. Webinar ID is 910208716/06. Or joined by telephone at 1-699-900-6833. Webinar ID is 910-208-71060. You may also submit your written comments limited to 250 words or less by emails to the Planning Commission Secretary at public comment cd-p@ci.salinas.ca.us. Every effort will be made to read your comment into the record, but it must be read due to limited time limitation. Reading of public comments, the Planning Commission Secretary shall read all email comments, provided that the reading shall not exceed 2 minutes. The email comments submitted shall become part of the record. I'll now call the meeting to order and lead you in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Angel?
Here.
Commissioner Griffin?
Here.
Commissioner North?
Here.
Commissioner Ottoni?
Here.
Commissioner Rocamora?
Here.
Chairperson Ming?
Yes.
Commissioner Manzo will not be joining us today.
Okay, thank you. Welcome to staff introductions, please.
Before we proceed, Mr. Ming, the city clerk has advised us that we have to make note of the continuation item. Would you like to make note of that? Or would you like me to?
I didn't receive that.
Okay. I just wanted to note that the appeal of the commercial cannabis permit 2020-014 and commercial cannabis permit 2020-015 has been continued to January 20th, 2021.
January 20th, okay.
My name is Myra Flores, Administrative Aid.
Bobby Latino, Associate Planner.
Courtney Grossman, Planning Manager.
Megan Hunter, Community Development Director.
Okay, Planning Secretary will now read any general public communications received by email on items that are not on the agenda and that are in the City of Salinas subject matter jurisdiction. Comments on consent, consideration, and public hearing items should be held until the items are reached. Planning Secretary, are there any comments from the public regarding items not on today's agenda?
There are no public comments for items not on the agenda.
Okay, then we'll begin with ID number, excuse me. We'll begin with ID number 20-526, approval of minutes from the November 4th, 2020 meeting. Are there any questions or comments from the commissioners? Commissioner Anzo?
No, not.
Commissioner Griffin?
No comments.
Commissioner Otone?
No comments.
Commissioner No?
No comments.
Commissioner Rocamora?
No comments.
Okay, is there a motion and a second?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
I'll second that.
Okay, with a motion from Commissioner Knorr and a second from Commissioner, I didn't get to see.
That was Commissioner Griffin.
Commissioner Griffin, we'll have a roll call vote, please.
Commissioner Anzo?
Yes.
Commissioner Griffin?
Yes.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Commissioner Otone?
Yes.
Commissioner Rocamora?
Yes.
Chairperson Mead?
Yes. Okay, public hearings. Item number 20-521, conditional use permit 2020-001, request for residential design review to convert 965 square feet of an existing 1099 attic into a second story addition within the existing single family dwelling unit located at 1054 University Avenue in the R-L-5.5 residential low density zoning district. Mr. Latino, will you present the PowerPoint, please?
Good afternoon, commissioners. Most of you are aware this is a continuation item from the November 4th, 2020 Planning Commission hearing, this item. I'll just kind of restate the background of it, which was just mentioned. It's conditional use permit 2020-001. It's a request to convert 965 square feet of an existing 1,099 square foot attic into a second story addition within an existing single family dwelling unit located at 1054 University Avenue in the residential low density zoning district. The recommended motion is to approve a resolution finding the project exempt pursuant to section 1531 of the CEQA guidelines, affirming the findings and approving conditional use permit 2020-001. Just to get into a quick background of the project once again, that was presented on November 4th. There's an existing attic space that was constructed back in 2014 under a building permit. The property owners, Eduardo Hilia and Nefte Guadalupe, converted the attic space into a second story addition without City of Salinas reviews or approvals and were cited under a code violation. Per the zoning code, a conditional use permit is required for residential design review for infill development, which includes second story additions to existing single family dwelling units. And a quick background from the November 4th, 2020 Planning Commission hearing. During the public comment period for this subject item, a letter was received in opposition from Barbara Chanon, dated November 4th, 2020, which was received and read into the record at the hearing and is within this staff report as well. Planning Commission did continue this item from the November 4th, 2020 Planning Commission hearing, and specifically asking staff to work with the applicant to minimize the bulk and scale by removing the two walled off attic spaces, identifying dormer windows to be frosted, louvered, or located at the top third of the wall, and mostly stepping back the front wall above the first story where the large window and balcony are located. So stepping back the addition ultimately. After the planning commission hearing, staff reached out to the applicant requesting such revisions to the plans. Applicant was given a deadline of the following Monday so to receive such plans so we could formalize a staff report. In response to the planning commission's request, the applicant identified in plans demolition of 134 square feet of extraneous second floor area by removal of interior attic partition walls, which is the two dormers or existing attic spaces towards the front of the addition, and placing a note of frosting the dormer windows, and stepping back of the front facade building wall above the first story where the large window and balcony are located with a new sloping roof line. It was kind of a vaulted ceiling area, and that's been removed and the front wall has been stepped back and a roof line has been added. This was the site plan, which did not change. Ultimately, the front yard setback is in conformance with the neighborhood block face, which is 20 feet. The front yard setback of the addition is 33 feet. The height, 24 feet, 1 inch, does not exceed the maximum allowed in the residential low density zoning district. In regards to the maximum size, which is 4,194 square feet, that's allowed. The applicant, with the new revision of plans, has identified demolition of 134 square feet in the second story addition area to comply. And addressing the privacy concerns with adjacent dwelling units, the second story windows are staggered from existing windows on the first story on the adjacent dwellings and have been, there's a note added that they've been frosted as well. This is a visual of the existing attic floor plan. And then to the right is a proposed second floor plan, which has a bubbled out area. This is in response to Planning Commission's request where they are removing part of the vaulted ceiling area and moving the wall back. It's hard to see, but there's dotted lines for demolition. Next one. These are the existing elevations. You'll notice that the front facade comes all the way out to the front wall. The front wall comes all the way out. And you'll see on the next proposed elevations that it's been stepped back. There is one thing to notice is the second story portion just over the garage is not identified correctly. It actually terminates at the ridge line of the garage. You'll see that in photos. So with the proposed elevation and per Planning Commission's request, there's bubbled out notes for the dormer windows that identify the frosted windows. And you also see on the front elevation on the bottom left, the wall has been stepped back and a new roof line has been proposed. And you'll kind of see it on the top right elevation as well, that front mass has been reduced. By reducing that front wall all the way to where the actual addition portion is. There's a vaulted ceiling area. And this is the colors and materials that were proposed and exist. For CEQA consideration, the project has been determined to be exempt from CEQA under Section 15301 existing facilities because the addition is less than 50% of the floor area of the existing dwelling unit before the addition. In conclusion, the project with the with Planning Commission's consideration and the November 9th, 2020 revised plans is consistent with the zoning code and the general plan. It is located on an infill site, which helps maintain a compact city form consistent with general plan land use policy LU 2.4. The proposed project conforms to community design element CD 2.3, which requires infill development to be consistent with the scale and character of existing neighborhoods. The second story addition will be compatible with adjacent properties because the front yard setback exceeds the average front yard setback of the neighboring block face. Second story addition is 33 foot setback, the neighboring block face is 20. Second story addition is stepped back 10 feet on the front elevation from where the front wall is, and 7 feet on the side elevations from the first story portions of the dwelling unit, which ultimately minimizes the scale and the bulk. That it concludes my presentation. Planning, the recommendation was for approval per the revised plans received in response to Planning Commission's request. Commissioners, have any further questions?
Are there any questions for Mr. Latino? Commissioner Anzo?
No, not at this time.
Commissioner Griffin?
No questions.
Commissioner Otone?
Yes, I have a question. Wanted to hear what staff's response was to the letter that was sent to us maybe about 5 minutes before the hearing from the applicant's architect, specifically regarding that there are other second floor additions along the street that that have similar massing, and a request that his estimation of these changes are not necessary.
Yeah, I'll take a shot at responding on that one. That letter came from the applicant's architect, and the property that's shown in that photograph was developed at a time that predates the current zoning code with the stepping back and the design requirements. So it's not necessarily an apples to apples comparison of the project in front of you versus what was constructed back. I'm not even sure when the time period of that particular house was constructed. Entirely different set of zoning rules.
All right, thank you.
In the last part of that, if I could, we're not exactly sure why plans came in that responded to the Planning Commission's direction if the applicant didn't want to construct that. That is somewhat of a mystery.
All right, that's what I suspected. Thank you.
Commissioner Knorr, any questions?
No comments, no questions at this time.
Commissioner Rocamora?
No questions.
Planning Secretary, are there any comments from the public regarding this item?
Yes, I will read the letter as it was addressed to the Planning Commission. And also, we have the applicant joining us for the webinar. So after I read the letter, if you'd like to allow them to make a statement, please advise.
If I could, if it's the same letter, maybe we don't need to read it.
The letter was submitted by David Elliott, and the attendees are different.
It's a different letter?
No, it's the same letter, right?
Sure.
Well, I guess go ahead and read it just to make sure it's in the record then.
Okay. The Honorable Commissioners and Mr. Latino, please accept this letter as response to neighborhood comments, staff and planning commissioner comments at the scheduled meeting of November 8, 2020 and continue to November 18th. First, regarding the email from Mr. E, the concern is that the addition of the home will invite multiple families to live there. There is a misunderstanding of the intention of the Kudeling family. The intended use is to take advantage of an attic space for music and sewing rooms. Any additional family would have to enter the main house to go upstairs, which is not reasonable for any renter. The process to convert the existing garage and convert up to 500 square feet of the existing house is a simple ministerial process due to new regulations established by city and recommended by the state. This is the owner's personal residence and they would never process such a permit. Mr. Keith resides at 555 San Felipe Drive, Salinas, California, 93901. A 3-minute drive to subject home. He is not in regular view of the project. Second is the email sent to prior to the meeting on November 8th by the westerly neighbor, Ms. Chagnon. These are more appropriate considerations that I would not be able to address until now due to the lateness of the email, though we are sympathetic to her concerns about scale, sun, and visibility from the second story. Please consider the following. The existing building was approved ministerially with planning sign-off through the normal buildings permit process. The building plans included all of the lower level design and attic. The city did not fail to issue any permit in due process. Additionally, we have removed the interior dormer framing so as not to be considered in the future. At the request of the staff, we have added translucent film over the small dormer windows to prevent any view of the adjacent homes to the north and south of the property in question. It was discussed at the hearing that the south and north elevations were already in compliance with architectural element setbacks and that the only issue is the front elevation. At the request of the commission, the project was continued to work with staff on a redesign that was acceptable. We completed that and is available for your discretion at the continued hearing. We show this as it was requested and now has staff suggesting approval of the commission as meeting of all needs. The 2-minute mark, the letter has been forwarded to the planning commission.
Thank you. Okay, are there any questions or comments from the commissioners to Mr. Letone or Latine? Commissioner Enzo?
No, not at this time.
Commissioner Griffin?
No.
Commissioner Atone?
No.
Commissioner Knorr?
No.
Commissioner Rocamora?
No.
Would any commissioners like to make a motion?
What about the applicant?
The applicant is online if you want to acknowledge them.
I think the applicant might have a thing or two to say, perhaps.
Is that Elizabeth Soto?
Would you like David Elliott to make a statement, the applicant?
Sure. Well, I mean, I don't even see them showing up on my screen, so I didn't know they were there.
Yeah, let the applicant know that he will be limited to 2 minutes.
Yeah, it'll be limited to, you will certainly be limited to 2 minutes. Thank you. Go ahead.
Mr. Elliott, if you can unmute yourself, you'll be limited to 2 minutes.
Mr. Elliott, please unmute your mic. There you
okay,
go.
Can everyone thank hear me now, okay?
And thank you.
All right, thank you for your time. So I think I think the letter explains itself. I think the mystery of why am I sending this letter at this point, I got the staff report on Friday and we wanted to readdress some things regarding the existing project. We favor leaving it the way it is. The reason that the other plans were sent is because that was requested. I sent an email on the 9th to Mr. Latino and suggesting exactly that he should address the staff report accordingly. And I re-forwarded that to him this morning and Courtney, and as well reverberated it. And so it's our choice to, we want you to reconsider the original application to leave the facade alone. We think that it doesn't affect any of the neighbors and all of the other issues we're in compliance with. Any questions for me?
Commissioner Anzo, any questions?
No.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yeah, I guess please clarify. So you're now rescinding your proposed submitted plan and you want to leave it as is and just delete the two interior elements, those little
that is our preference. I stated that when I sent just after sending that those plans, I thought you wanted to see what the consequences of what you were asking was all about, and I qualified it as such so that we preferred considering leaving it the way it was.
Anything else, Matt?
No, thank you.
Commissioner Griffin?
No questions.
Commissioner Raton?
I have no questions.
Commissioner Rocamora?
My question is, how come the plans weren't submitted the first time instead of just doing what you guys, you guys wanted to just build an attic and now it changed? Why did you not, if you knew you were going to build this, why didn't you turn those plans in?
Not something I could answer. I wasn't the original architect. So that plan went through as a building permit only for the second level. Yeah, I can't.
Can I respond to that?
The owner would like to respond to that.
Mr. Yakamura, good afternoon. Good afternoon, everybody. The reason to do that is because I got my, I play music and my wife make art, pictures and a lot of things. The problem for us going upstairs in the second floor is really narrow stairs. Because in the beginning, I want to leave only like a case man space. But when I started my wife to do the sculptures and paint and all his stuff to make the rooms that way. So, but it's nothing to affect any of the neighbors. And it's something to increase the price for all the neighbors. It's not nothing to affect anybody. It's my
tell me. But why didn't you go back to planning and let them know that you're changing your plans to get that approved? Why did you not get permits for it?
Well, you writing that, I make a mistake because I think, well, I was going to do this thing a little bit later, increase a little bit more the things, but I don't make any exterior change or anything to affect anything, anybody, because that plans in the beginning is approved like as is.
Hmm. And did another thing, did you talk to your neighbors before you even decided to build up to get their opinion on what they thought, your neighbors right next door to you?
No, I don't bother anybody. I don't bother anybody.
Well, they didn't ask you.
And the neighbors would know me around here. It's no complaint. The next neighbor next door is no complaint.
Admittingly, the process was flawed. We got notice from the city that a permit wasn't prepared. That's when I was hired to correct the plans for the upstairs. It seemed pretty simple with the process. We got staff's approval at your last, what we were doing. You got an email from the neighbor a couple hours before the meeting, and that sort of set the tone for changing this in the context. So that's why we did this. No excuse for not going through this process initially on our own, but now we're there.
Right. The problem I have here is it's basically setting precedent, like the owner said, for anybody here in Salinas to put in plans for a permit and then change it and then say, oh, sorry, I messed up, but here's the new plans. You see what I'm saying?
Of course.
You know, if you allow this, then that means that anybody can go out there in Salinas and just apply for a regular permit and then change the plans and say, whoops, it was my mistake. Here's the new plans. You see what I'm saying? That's what we're looking at.
You're right, Mr. Yagamona, but the point is, I wanna be in the law with you guys. And I excuse myself to you guys, and I please approve my plans. There's nothing wrong with anything. I really appreciate you. Help me to leave everything like this because my wife took super to put it upstairs, all the big things to make the paint. You can't do it the other way. Okay. You can't do it in the small, in the really narrow spaces.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I understand what you're saying. It's just that it was just going around the permitting process. And that's the problem we're having here in Salinas with permitting. And if we're allowing that, then we're allowing anybody just to change that up. That's the whole thing. It's following the rules where everybody should be following the same rules.
Yeah. You're also welcome to come and see the house if you want.
I see the pictures, yeah.
But nothing changed on the exterior, understanding that proper procedure was not taken care of. And that's why we're trying to correct it. And then we're getting hit because of a neighbor's letter, something that doesn't affect her property at all. We've already dealt with that stuff on the exterior and the rear. It's only the front. And this is a very expensive, they'll have to move out of their house and spend $80,000 to fix it. I know that's not a reason for deciding on this, but it's just a fact.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Before I ask for a motion or a second, are there any other questions from the commissioners?
Chair, if I may, I want to go back to the issue at hand was that the current condition, if it was submitted at that time as a second floor habitable space, the issue was it would have not met the zoning code requirements for massing the front floor setback. I think that's being kind of overlooked and brushed under here. Is that, maybe I'm misunderstanding or recalling incorrectly, but I thought that was the whole point is what we're just asking for it to be brought into consistency with the zoning if the project were to come forward under regular terms of the front setback for a second floor.
So I'll chime in here. If this were submitted as a second story project, it would have had more scrutiny. The requirements of a second story addition are different than a one story addition with a big attic. There is stepping back requirements. There are pictures in the zoning code that show what to do, what not to do. The stepping back would have been a condition or a design feature of the project going through a formal conditional use permit process. Plus the roof line would have had some more attention to it as well. It's a long roof line to the backyard. Normally that is broken up with changes in roof planes and so forth. Those requirements of the second story design review were not applied to this project.
Thank you.
Okay, before I ask for a motion and second, I'd like a little clarification from the staff. If we have a motion and second, and we approve the conditional use permit, does that approve it with the changes that we're asking to be done, or will it remain as it is?
The project before you is the revised plans that the applicant doesn't want to do. So the recommendation is to approve the plan submitted by the applicant, which would result in modifications to the front building elevation, as well as the interior walls within the attic, the frosting of the windows. The applicant would receive approval, but there would be construction requirements that the applicant would need to follow. Of course, the permit has a 10-day appeal period. The applicant could determine to appeal that decision and take this conversation to the city council.
Chair, may I ask a question? If the applicant does not like this concept that was proposed, and the commission, if it so desires, does not care for the original concept, does the applicant maybe want to consider yet another alternative design that may be less impactive but just as creative to break up the bulk and mass? I don't know if that's something the applicant and their architect want to consider, and if that's something that the commission would want to do as well. I don't want to continue him again if he doesn't want to, but I think we're trying to work with him, and I'm just throwing out some options for consideration.
One consideration with regard to another continuance is that I think we've run out of time on the shot clock for the consideration of the appeal. I think this is the last meeting available to the Planning Commission for such decision unless the applicant were to extend the timing for consideration of the appeal at the Planning Commission level.
Yeah. Okay. Any comment from the attorney on that? Apparently not. Okay, in that case, I will...
Do we want to ask the applicant if they're willing to offer a continuance so they can resolve it?
Didn't I just do that and nobody answered?
Oh, they might. I don't know. They might have to be unmuted.
So I have an additional question for Courtney and the staff, if we have a minute before we go there. Megan?
Yes, please.
Okay, so Courtney, if I understand you correctly, I understand this is, if this had been a second story addition proposal initially, that it would have received additional scrutiny and the changes that we're requesting likely would have been required at that time. However, this was not a second story addition. This was just a roof line for the modification of the home in what was a single story plan. But at the root of the problem is the fact that in the approval of the permit, the city and staff missed the fact that this roof line was higher than would have typically been approved. Is that correct?
You're partway there. The review, in my opinion, could have produced a different outcome. It would have allowed the neighborhood to participate in the dialogue and the discussion of the design at a Planning Commission meeting, perhaps. That would have resulted in a different physical appearance. The roofline is compliant for a one-story house. The trouble is, and this is something we've got to look at, is the zoning code probably is not perfect. And in the future, we might want to look at some changes to how this process works. This is not the first time that attics have been converted. I think this is probably the second or the third time we've been down this path before. In most cases, they tear down the roof or they put it back to an attic in the past. But I can't say for sure that the outcome would have been different, but it would have had different scrutiny. It would have been reviewed by multiple people within the department in the division. And I don't think I would have thought that this design and the roof line was compliant.
All right. Well, here's what I'm struggling with is they went through the single story process to get the approval for this roof line, which they received for the exterior of the home that we see was approved. The fact that they then began to use that second story as a living space and were got a code violation for that is sort of a secondary issue. We're in a position right now where we are asking the applicant to spend a significant amount of money on changing this roof line when the process could have been done better in the first place to change that. It's like we're expecting them to pay for our mistake. And that's where I'm having a problem with this, is the exterior of the home has been approved in that initial process. But now we're asking, because they want to live in it, we want them to change that exterior at great expense. And while I am not interested in creating some sort of precedent for people in the city to do whatever they like, I'm also not keen on asking this applicant to spend $100,000 to adjust a roof line by 10 feet.
I was just going to say, I don't think it was a mistake. I mean, the reason why we don't have the same level of scrutiny for what came before us versus second story space is really about the privacy and, you know, the way that if you are up there, you're obviously looking into people's space. And the one thing, keep in mind too, this hasn't gone through the building process. And we don't know, you know, when this project was approved, they didn't consider occupant loads. So I suspect that the person that they're going to have to reevaluate this in terms of building permitting compliance, because it was supposed to be a different occupancy type. So sure. I agree with you. I do understand what you're saying from an exterior standpoint.
So my part of my concern is that, is this area on the front elevation of the home that we're asking them to step back 10 feet, is that, I understood in our previous discussion that that was essentially a vaulted room from the first floor, that the window that we see in the photograph now on the front of the home above the front door, that just opens into a high ceiling from the first floor. Is that correct?
Yeah, I think there's a staircase below it as well, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. Okay, I'm just trying to get it, just trying to get a sense of really what we're asking and what the impact is going to be on the home. And quite frankly, is it worth it?
And one thing that the commission can do, the commission can determine findings that indicate that this house meets the zoning code, that it is not detrimental to the neighborhood, that it conforms with the regulations and so forth. You would basically be affirming the resolution prepared, but you'd be swapping out the plans as some sort of an alternative, perhaps. But what
I'm wondering, Courtney, because I think it's going to be a challenge, right? Because we prepared the report with a revision. I'm wondering if not advisable to do a continuance to see if there's a different way that would be less expensive to provide some break, as I think Commissioner Knorr suggested. And, or, you know, the other option, if it's the Planning Commission's desire to move forward with kind of the original, is to modify the findings. Is that what you need time to do?
Well, I think the Planning Commission can make findings that the current project as is meets the code. I think that's up to the commission. It's a judgment call. That's one thing.
Do we have findings that they can utilize as guideposts that we've already prepared?
Sure. They could make findings on the dais. It's usually not my preference to do it that way, but the commission has that capability.
Well, yeah, no, I understand that, but I'm wondering if the applicant would consent to providing more time, would it make sense to not do it on the dais, but give us the desire of the commission and then come back? That's your call, Courtney. I think you have a better sense of if that would make sense.
Looking at meetings in the future, December 2, I think it'd be quite difficult to meet that one. The reports would have to be prepared during the holidays. That's an option. December 16 is another option. One of these meetings I think we were concerned about in terms of timing, but with the applicant's consent, yes, we can go to a later date and come back again.
I guess if I may, I
for the commission, just for consideration, I mean, is it, it's really kind of a value, you know, a position of how much do importance are we putting on the bulk and mass on the front elevation versus the two sides, which are the most impactful to the neighbors. And if we find that, hey, even with this revised design, the general bulk and mass doesn't change the impact to the adjacent two neighbors, and it's really something just perceived from the public right of way, you know, I mean, is it really gonna, you know, hurt us so much, if you will? I mean, there are some nice elements to this building, but I think, you know, certainly additional articulation may benefit, but certainly $100,000, I mean, that's a tough one to swallow. I can understand the concern there, you know, but my position is not one to judge on cost. It's just more of to evaluate based on zoning requirements. That's our task here.
And if I have,
Commissioner Norrie, to your point, the way I understand that front elevation, that front window, there's no one looking out that front window, correct? That's just bringing light into that first story and towards that stairwell, that's not overlooking any neighbor's property. It's just looking right of way, and that's not where anyone is intruding on the neighbor's privacy.
I see. So you're it's not habitable space is what you're positioning.
Yeah, that's the way I understand it. Correct.
If I may, I went by the place just the other day, and you know, compared to every other home in the local area, you say within about two or three blocks, there is nothing as large as this house. It's huge. And it stands at least a full floor above the houses on each side. It extends almost all the way to the back line of the lot. It's just, and I'd have to see the floor plan again, but it seems to me that all we're asking them to do is, well, they took out a partition, which opened up the whole space. They took what was the Jacob's ladder out and put in a staircase. Well, a staircase had to go to a floor, didn't it? Which means possibly, without looking at the plans again, that space in the front of the house is usable and habitable. I would prefer, I would suggest to, if you know, either continuance or we just settle this matter now. That's up to the commission.
I still have a question on Megan's point about load bearing, on the load bearing. So if something was to happen, we approve this, and something was to happen, and we approve it, would the city be liable?
No, they're still gonna have to go by and permit it.
Okay, because you know—
Right, Courtney, am I saying anything different than your understanding?
Right now it's an illegal condition. It has unlawful occupancy. It has unlawful zoning compliance. And just to give a little bit of insight into the infill regulations, the height and scale of the addition shall follow the context of the neighbor block face, not overwhelm existing dwelling units with disproportionate size. That's a shall. It also says additions shall preserve and reinforce the character of established streetscapes by maintaining similar horizontal and vertical proportions with adjacent facades. So there is some language in the code that can be deemed desirable by the Planning Commission, if that's the case. And just to make note, there are members of the public, again, Mr. Elliott and Enrique Eckhouse had his hand up. Apparently they want to talk some more.
Okay. I see these people aren't on my screen, so if they'd like to speak, address the commission further, please do so.
Courtney, I don't know if Myra's there, but the way that it has to work is Myra needs to alert if people's hands are raised and let them in and out of the webinar. That's how Patty does it, because the commissioners can't operate or see that.
And she let me know that the hands are coming up.
Okay, I see Mr. Elliott's name on the screen now. Mr. Elliott, would you like to continue to address the commission?
Of course. All of this conversation, I completely understand. And we've missed, this all being taken care of originally. We are very interested in Megan's comment about continuing this so that we could take another look at it. So we'd appreciate that opportunity.
Okay. Any other questions from the commissioners? Would any commissioner like to propose that we continue this to a later meeting?
I recommend we make a motion. I recommend we continue this item to next meeting, allowing the applicant to further study their options for the articulation opportunities on the front elevation.
Do we have a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, with a motion from Commissioner Knorr and a second from Commissioner Atone to continue this to a later date. And what we suggest, Tony, either the 6th or the 16th, you said?
Well, yeah, we have to determine. You need to determine a date specific. December 2 is going to be tight. Okay. December 16th, next one.
Might I suggest we continue it with the applicants agreeing to that to the 16th? That will also give them more time to really study and explore what they might be able to do that's economically feasible.
Mr. Ellis, does that sound fair to you?
Yes, that's fair. That'd give us more time to look at options. And quite frankly, I wouldn't mind talking with the neighbor, showing her what we're doing.
Okay, well, the contact, whether or not you contact the neighbor is up to you. But so what we have is an acceptance by the petitioner to continue this to the 16th, and we have a motion and a second. Can we have a roll call vote on that? A motion from Commissioner Knorr and a second from Commissioner, I forgot already.
O'Tone.
Commissioner O'Tone, yes. To continue this until the 16th of December. Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Anzal?
Yes.
Commissioner Griffin?
Yes.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Commissioner
Tony? Yes.
Commissioner Rocamora?
Yes.
Chairperson Meek?
Yes. With that vote, we have the continuance of this item, which is item number 20-001, which was a request for residential design review to convert a 965 feet square foot of existing 1099 attic into a second story addition within the existing single family dwelling unit located at 1054 University Avenue in the R-L-5.65 residential low density zoning district, continued until the 16th of December. Thank you. Okay. The other two have been continued until a later date, which is the appeal, which is item number 5-24, appeal of the selection committee's denial of two commercial cannabis business permits for distribution CCP 2020-014 and manufacturing CCP 2020-015 located at 743 Sanborn Place in the IG-GW-5-AR Industrial General Sanborn and at US 101 Gateway Overlay Airport District has been continued. Do we have a date on that, Courtney?
I think that's coming up in January for the cannabis. The,
January
20th. I've been informed January 20 for cannabis.
Okay, are there any other business? follow-up reports?
I'm not aware. I'm not aware of any follow-up reports.
Okay. Future agenda items. Of course, now we know the 16th and the 20th, the 16th of December and the 20th of January. Any other items other than those?
There are a couple more out there, but the dates are not certain. There were a couple employee housing projects on three separate addresses. It's been continued indefinitely right now. We don't have a date. My guess it's going to be in 2021.
Okay. Given that our next regular scheduled meeting is December the 2nd, 2020.
I did have one follow-up item.
Go ahead, Megan.
Sorry to interrupt. So we're about to embark on the general plan, finally. And one thing that we are interested in having is we're going to be establishing a steering committee. We are going to have a different representation on the steering committee. And we are interested in having one member of the planning commission sit upon that steering committee. We'll probably wait because I know, you know, with elections, there may be some changes mm-hmm. to the planning commission. But for those who might be interested, I just want to keep that in mind. I know some of you aren't experiencing a change in your city council member. So we definitely are looking for someone who can be active in that process. So just wanted to mention that.
Got me for at least two more years.
Megan, I have a quick question regards to that.
Commissioner Cohn. Sure.
What other type of individuals are going to be placed on the steering committee? Categories of individuals, or how's that going to work?
Yeah, we're still kind of finalizing it. But one thing that we have are discussing is that having each council member, including the mayor, have I don't want to say an appointment because it's not official, but select a representative that would represent the geographic area. So we have talked about that. And then we are working on kind of different stakeholder groups, like, for instance, the faith community, you know, identifying someone of the faith for the faith community. We probably are looking to have maybe a representative from both MST and TAMSE, just because I think they're going to be so instrumental to the, you know, how the city is built out in the future. So we're still working on it. But if you have any suggestions, we're definitely open to, you know, if you feel that there's someone who should be represented. We did apply for a grant. We'll see if we receive it. It's sustainable agricultural lands and conservation grant, that if we get that grant, we would actually establish an agricultural subcommittee. And we would actually weave kind of agriculture into the general plan as a theme, because obviously the, you know, Salinas is so tied to the agricultural economy, and so many of our people work in the ag industry, and ag housing is big. So we thought it would be really neat to do something like that. But we don't know if we got the grant yet. So that's to come.
All right, thanks.
Any other questions from the commissioners?
I might give just a quick update. Last night, City Council approved the Central Area Specific Plan. I'm not sure if the commissioners were aware of that or not.
Absent the two items which need a second reading, which is the rezone and the development agreement, which come back on December 1st to City Council. But the environmental document and the specific plan were approved.
Yeah, just want to thank the commission for working quickly on that project. It was a heavy lift, and we appreciate your work on that.
Okay, if there's no further comments or questions, the meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.
Have a- have a good Thanksgiving.